I'm not judging intelligence. If you're a person who has a following, I don't want to make you famous. If I have a debate with you, you'll be seen by 100 million people. You know that? Now, let me complete my answer. What I tell any non-Muslim, many hundreds of non-Muslims want to debate with me. I tell them, there are hundreds of Hindus who I know, hundreds of Christians who I know. When they speak, they have more than 10,000 people for the audience. Shri Shri Ravi Shankar, Ramdev Baba, Christians, Billy Graham, Franklin Graham, Maurice Cirello, Benny Hinn, all these people, they have 10,000, 20,000, 50,000, 100,000 for the gathering. You convince them and give your material to them. Let them debate me. They will never take your material knowing very well. It will not stand the test. These are scholars of your religion. What I tell you, if you really feel you have strong material and you really think you have intelligence, give this material to a Hindu who you consider to be best.
Okay.
And who has a following. If you say, I want to debate with you, I used to do that earlier. Now, anyone, whether good, bad, ugly, whether he's intelligent or not, if he can gather 10,000 people, that means he has a following. He's not doing it for fame. And then we will have a public dialogue. For you, you can have a dialogue with my student. When you're coming to Bombay, tell me. I've got hundreds of students.
Fair
many.
Enough. Fair enough.
You know, we have students in our school. We have many people. And they love it. So the list goes, you want to debate? Come to Bombay. Give me the time. 1, 2, 3, 4. We have many.
Fair enough.
Fine.
May I have the answers to my questions?
I'm coming.
Thank you.
But because you made a challenge before, the challenge is more important than the answer. The answers I've already given many times. I'll come to it. So there, this is your assumption. This is what I say. I'm not here to criticize it unless someone forces me to. That I said because Rahul was arguing so much. That's why I said. Otherwise, in my talk, I'm not here to criticize any religion.
Thank you.
That's what I wanted to hear from you.
Religion
is beyond criticism. It's beyond...
But you have to call a spade a spade. If you say, why is the teacher saying 2 plus 2 is 3 is wrong? That teacher criticizes. He's not criticizing. If someone is forcing, no, I'm right. 2 plus 2 is 3. 2 plus 2 is 3.
You see, just because somebody else's perspective does not agree with yours, because he's following a different religion or sect.
No religion. 2
does,
plus
does
2
does not
is...
mean that that person is wrong.
2 plus 2 is equal to 4 is a universal fact. Now, someone comes from the village and tells me 2 plus 2 is 3. Main pyar se bolunga. I'll tell him with love. But yes, if he insists, I said, no, brother, it's enough. So because I'm in this field, alhamdulillah, I'm not here to criticize, but someone forces me to criticize. Okay, give me one example of unscientific thing. I can give you. I don't want to hurt the other Hindus. I want to win them over. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Fusilat, chapter 41, verse number 34, that you get them closer with love. Win your enemy, don't defeat them. So all these people, I'm winning them over. I'm not defeating them. Neither do I want to defeat you, I want to win you, brother.
Well, I guess if one
would Inshallah, win, I will win you with your two answers.
One way to win somebody is through humility. And you've reached that stage where, you know, as a person grows larger than life,
yes,
he becomes more humble.
Correct.
For you to say that I would not challenge you, I mean, you
no,
know.
No, but once you reach a stage, if that is causing loss, Allah also says, I'll put you in hell. He is much higher than me, infinite time. But that does not mean should go against the message. Humility doesn't mean that me being humble to you, I'm giving a wrong signal to millions of people. Then it will be injustice. I can't be humble. Okay, 2 plus 2 is 3. Very good, son. Other 1,000 people will start calculating 2 plus 2 is 3 because Zakir has said. That's not humility, that is injustice, dishonesty. Right? Now coming to your questions.
Thank you.
The first question the brother asked is, which he said it comes in the first 13. It was the 11th most common question or misconception in the mind of the non-Muslim, that if Islam is against idol worship, why do you bow down to the Kaaba when you offer Salah? No Muslim ever worships the Kaaba when you offer Salah. Kaaba is the Qibla, it is the direction. We Muslims, we believe in unity. Now when we offer Salah, suppose you want to offer Salah here, some will say less faith, north, some will say south, some will say east, some will say west. For unity, Allah says in the Quran Surah Baqarah that wherever you are, face towards the Kaaba. So Kaaba is the Qibla, it is the direction. So we are facing in that direction, but no one worships the Kaaba. Previously, the Muslims were the first people to do the world map. And Al-Idrusi, 1154, he drew the world map. North Pole down, South Pole was on top. And Kaaba was in the center. The Western cartographers came and they turned the map upside down. North Pole top, South Pole down. Yet the Kaaba is in the center. So if you're in the north, you face towards the south. If you're in the south, you face towards the north. If you're in the east, you face towards the west. If in the west, you face towards the east. Kaaba is at the center. So we pray that as a Qibla, as a direction. No one worships it. Further, when we go for Umrah, or for pilgrimage, or for Hajj, we circumambulate around the Kaaba. You may ask that, why do you circumambulate around the Kaaba? Why do you circle around the Kaaba? I do it because of the commandment from Almighty God and the Prophet. But the logical reason I can think is because every circle has only one center. So when we circumambulate around the Kaaba, logically I think we are testifying there's one God. Furthermore, if yet you have doubts, if you read the hadith that's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of Hajj, chapter 56, hadith number 675, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he was the second caliph of Islam, second khalifa. He said that this black stone pointing at the Hajar Aswad, black stone, it can neither benefit me, it can neither harm me. Just because my Prophet kissed it, I'm kissing it. This statement that this black stone can neither harm anyone nor benefit anyone is sufficient to prove that the Muslims don't worship the Kaaba. Furthermore, at the time of the Prophet, there were Sahabas, there were companions of the Prophet who stood on the Kaaba and gave the Azan. No idol worshipper will ever stand on the idol and give the Azan, proving that no Muslim ever worshipped the Kaaba. It's only the Qibla, it's a direction. Coming to a second question. Hope you're convinced with the first question.
Sure I am. Thank you.
Very good. 50% I've won you over. Now next 50%. Your second question was, decades earlier, centuries earlier, there was no clock, no way to keep time. So we could justify that giving Azan was right. Now everything is there, clock is there, time is there. So why do we have to give the Azan? Very good question. The reason we give the Azan is for many things. One thing is to tell everyone it is time. You tell me one thing. Everyone has the watch during examination. Yet the teacher rings the bell, time is up. So you tell the school teacher, why are you ringing the bell that the period is up? Everyone has a watch. To tell everyone, finish, time is up, next period. So today when we have the Azan, you can have a big clock also, a big bell. But a Prophet said, bell is not good. Therefore in Christian you have bell, some religion you have the drum. The Prophet said, no, this is not good. No drum, no bell. Someone suggested human voice, he liked it. So better than the drum, we have of course human voice, and our Azan has a message. The bell, sometimes the bell in the school has a message, period is up. Sometimes the bell has a message, period is starting. Sometimes the bell has a message, different message. That fire alarm, run away. You understand, no? Bell cannot speak. You read the bell, okay, fire is there, run away. In the Azan, it has a message. It says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest. God is the greatest. 4 times. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. That I bear witness there is no God but Allah. He's calling out. I bear witness there is no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Hayal salah, hayal salah. Come to salah, come to salah. Hayal falah, hayal falah. Come to success, come to success. He's giving you a message. God is the greatest, God is the greatest, God is the greatest, God is the greatest. 4 times. There is no God but Allah. Prophet Muhammad is the messenger, giving you a message that your messenger, Prophet Muhammad, you don't have to worship him. He is only a messenger. He is the servant of God. 5 times you are reminded in the Azan. Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. He is not Allah. Come to Salah, come to prayers, come to prayers, come to success, come to success. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. So it's a message telling you it is time for prayer. At the same time testifying there's one God, it is a message. And the beauty of it is that whichever part of the world you go, it's only in Arabic. So if you have in French, if you go to France, you don't understand French, you say, what is the person shouting? Is he abusing me? So throughout the world you have in Arabic. Even if I don't know Arabic, at least I know the translation of the Azan. So it is a reminder. In the morning salah, another reminder. It says, As-salatu khairun min an-nawm. Prayer is better than sleep. As-salatu khairun min an-nawm. prayers. Now when you hear, prayer is better than sleep, so you get up. With the ghanta, I put the snooze on. You know snooze? Another 10 minutes. Another snooze, 10 minutes. Here, as-salatu khairum minan naum. Only for the morning's azan. Prayer is better than sleep. So here it's a message. Even though you have watched, you don't keep on watching. So now, because we pray in congregation, our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, there are no less than 3 hadith in Sahih Bukhari, which says that you get 25 times, 27 times more sawab when you pray in congregation. So the azan is reminding you that the congregation is going to start. So you know once the azan is given, within 20 minutes, the congregation will start. So you get ready, you do your wudu, you do your ablution, and you go to the mosque. If it is not there, and many people don't know what is the time, it keeps on changing. I will not know what's the time for sunset today. Do you know, brother? Do you know the time for morning sunrise in Dubai?
It changes every day. So
what is it now, you know?
Not rough.
Most of the people here will have rough idea. So, though you are a scientific person, you have a watch. If the azan is there, now it is time, I'll go for prayer. So even in the age of science and technology, it's a reminder. And besides the reminder, it's giving you a message. It's calling you towards the truth, it's calling you towards success. So that's the reason even 100 years, 1000 years back it was correct. Even today it is correct, and even tomorrow it will be correct. Hope this convinces you.
Thank you kindly.
So at least in these questions I won you over.
Yes, you have. Thank
Inshallah.
You.
Inshallah. And I pray to God to guide you and to guide me also. Thank you.
The next question from the sister's mic.
Yes, my question is, as a Muslim wife, I know my duty is not to serve my husband's parents. But if his mother is...